crisis about jobs because technology is rapidly changing the way we do things. On the one hand, jobs are becoming more efficient and many boring tasks can be done by computers and robots. On the other hand, there are simply less jobs remaining. We are all somewhat familiar with this crisis. Just think about the plant shutdowns and layoffs that we see in the papers and on the news. We can also see that we are in a crisis from the following statistics about unemployment. The Center for New Work estimates that 12% of the people in this country are underemployed. This includes those that can only get part-time work, and those working in jobs that are far below their educational level. 8% are caught in jobs below the poverty line. 4% are involuntarily retired. 6% are in public assistance, such as welfare and ADC. 4% are discouraged workers who are no longer looking for work. And 6% are the officially unemployed. So a total of 40% of the population is unemployed in one form or another. In this series, we will examine the crisis, looking at how manufacturing, service jobs, and the professions are changing. We will also explore the solutions that Professors Bergman and Gull have come up with.
There are far, far fewer entry-level jobs available. When I started out 5 years ago, I went around Flint, but also other towns, and I gave talks, and I said, as many as 50% of all the jobs might be displaced in one way or the other, either through outsourcing or through increased competitiveness or through increased technology and things. And at that point, a lot of people thought that was just wildly exaggerated. At this point, the very sort of the authoritative, conservative people who wear suits like you say things just like that. You know? People like Dave Cole, who is director of the Institute for Automobile Research in Ann Arbor, says at least half of all the people working will be, you know, laid off.
It's no longer can you learn a skill such as stick welding and get a job, expect to get a job because the robot actually does the welding. You're going to have to tend the robots.
Exactly. I mean, and welding, that's a wonderful example. Welding is just the kind of thing that robots are, you know, that's grist on their mill. Welding is what robots were made to do, and they can do it. But one of the things to mention that I think it may be a little painful for people to acknowledge and come to terms with, but it's only just around the corner. I mean, we are now moving rapidly closer to have voice printers, to have, you know, computers that can take your voice and turn it into written, printed text. And you know, there are numerous people who think that if they know how to type, you know, typing will be an entry into a job. And the typing actually will rapidly decrease that's required, and that what typing has to be done will mainly be done directly by machine. The executives will just read their letters and get them printed out that way, and nobody will take dictation and type for them anymore.
Sounds to me like we've seen, maybe I'm wrong, we've seen a shift where the unskilled, shall we say, graduating from high school, formerly could get a job with a manufacturing plant such as General Motors or whatever, without a lot of skills, but anymore, they're probably excluded from an awful lot of jobs and perhaps will end up in the service industries.
We are moving further in the kind of direction in which we are now moving, and we are moving fast. Now. Well, anybody ought to be able to see that on $3.50 an hour, especially if it's only part-time, you can't buy an Oldsmobile. Now, I mean, in a recent lecture, I heard somebody say that on a minimum wage, even if it's full-time, it amounts to $6,000 a year. Well, if you work part-time, that may be only $3,000. On that, you cannot afford an Oldsmobile or a Buick or even a Chevy.
I heard that same lecture, and the point was that, you know, $6,000 a year is not even poverty wages.
Right.
Even poverty would be better than the situation with people in some minimum wage jobs.
Exactly. So, I mean, it seems to me that if management sort of thought about it from a business perspective, they would say, the only way we can maintain the level of cars that have to be sold is by making it possible for people to make good wages at part-time jobs
and to do something productive and interesting as well in the rest of the time, because if everybody, or the vast majority of people, move into something close to minimum wage service jobs, hamburger flipping jobs, the market will collapse. There will be no one around to buy these things.
The series will reflect different opinions from the many people that Professors Bergman and Gall have interviewed.
I mean, consider, for example, if you work 6 days, 9 hours, how much time do you have to even investigate alternatives? How much time do you have to cultivate whatever talent or aspiration you might have? You're lucky if you, especially people with families, you're lucky if you just get home and take care of your responsibilities at home.
One time I can believe that it wasn't so bad to be unemployed if you remember the UAW, you know, because the UAW fought very hard to make sure that there were some means of surviving during periods of unemployment. But we're in a whole different situation now because we're in a period of unemployment now that is permanent. You know, it's a period of unemployment where I can't say, well, my unemployment and sub-benefits will carry me through this. I already experienced that in 81, where all of that ran out. It's very frightening to be unemployed because I don't know what's out there for me now.
What other things need to be done as this whole recomposition, this restructuring of the auto industry takes place? What is the UAW proposing for the future?
Well, certainly if it could be worked right, there's many ways that you could handle it through, whether it be job sharing, whether it be a shorter work week, to help compensate. But we still do have to have laws, like other countries have. If the other countries get the laws off the books, like I said, our country, our workers can compete with anyone there is.
This series is not only about the auto industry. Although the auto industry is most visible when it comes to looking at the effects of automation and job elimination, we will look at changes in the service sector and the professions as well.
It's because the fact that not only the jobs that are low-skilled jobs and sometimes low-wage jobs are changing or being automated. I mean, the better way of thinking about it is that all of work, all jobs are changing. And it's not just automation that is changing them. No? It's all sorts of other things as well that are going into it. But a sort of phrase that helps is to think in terms of a transformation of work, now that there's a transformation of all jobs going on.
People talk about education being so essential in the future, how you just can't make it without education. Like, for instance, a few years ago, about 10 years ago, if you had your high school diploma, you could get a job. But it's coming to the point where a high school diploma just isn't enough. The jobs aren't out there. You need to be more educated for them. People have heard about these, students have heard about these things, but yet it seems like they don't want to react.
Although this series will present many alarming facts, there is hope. As you will see, we are at a point in time when we have exciting opportunities that have never existed before. Professors Fritjof Bergman and Richard Gull have been studying the future of work, examining the direction in which technology is taking us. They have founded the Center for New Work in Flint, Michigan. The center is developing ways in which society can adapt to the changes that are occurring.
Now, one of the things that in the Center for New Work, that's a whole new topic and it's very difficult to sum up, but part of what we do try to help people with is slowly acquaint themselves with the possibility of a kind of different lifestyle, where it may become much more the general pattern that people will work periodically, that they will work not at one job for 30 years, but at different jobs, and there will be spaces in between where they won't have jobs.
If you think in terms of work going back down, that just there simply will be less work available, given the kind of technology we have, given how jobs are moving abroad, there is no way. It is utterly out of the question to recreate the situation that everybody will be able to work for 30 or 40 years out of their life, 40 hours a week for 50 weeks. It's just out of the question. It will have to go down. There's nothing we can do to bring it back up again. That's, you know, sort of the overall perspective with which I work. And a possible way of thinking about this is if you do The first thing that people think of is, well, let's reduce the work week. Let's go from 5 to 4 to 3 or something like that. And it seems to me that that's a very unimaginative way of going about the problem. That actually, there is something one can do at just this point, and it looks like something very small. And all the same, it is the most decisive difference. It's sort of like a railroad switch. There's nothing to it. But if it points one way, you end up in Mexico. If it points in the other way, you end up in Canada. And the railroad switch, in my mind, has to do with what I think of as rotating work schedules. That is, the idea is, rather than cut down the work week, have people work in larger chunks, but then have large chunks of free time. Have 6 months of fairly intensive work, and then have 6 months of job free time. Or have a whole year of fairly intensive work, and then have a whole year of job free time. Or have 3 months, 3 months, or 3 years, 3 years. There are all kinds of variations on this. But the basic idea is to push it together, to not have little bits of work and little bits of leisure. If you had 3 months, or if you had 6 months, well, that would be time to do something productive, to do something worthwhile, to do something that might make life cheaper, better, more worthwhile. The advantages of that would be, in addition to the one I just mentioned, that one would have some sense of security. One would have some sense of knowing what's going to happen. What happens now? Now, is that people spend a tremendous amount of time when they are out of work waiting, worrying, looking for another job, getting depressed, feeling dreadful. If the whole thing were at least made predictable, if we created a situation so that people would know what's going to happen, I think that by itself would be a tremendous advantage.
The idea that a large number of people in a community have these large slices of time means that that time off the job isn't necessarily private time. It's time to be involved with other people, to get together with other people on projects. I think one of the things that's so frightening about unemployment is that one is isolated. Mm-hmm. One sees that in our culture very often as a personal failure. If there's going to be a solution to the plight of being unemployed, it's something that you as an individual must do. The notion of the 6 months off needn't be that. It needn't be the private. It can be the opportunity to get together with other people without the constraints of the individual paycheck and decide these are things that we want to do. Maybe it's that for this 6 months, five of us will get together and we'll build a house for one, and next time we have time off, we build a house for another.
We are at a place where the tide is coming in. We're at a place where a wave is coming in. If we don't move, no, there will be tremendous increase in low-income population. There might be 50, 60, 70, 80%, no, who are living in a very, very, very sort of marginal way. But if we made that kind of change or other changes like those, the wave could move us up. And we could have a much better life, because if people worked at something that they cared about, they would be almost different people. It makes a tremendous difference whether you are humiliated by what you do, whether you are embarrassed by what you do, whether what you do makes you feel ashamed, or whether you really feel pride in the work you do. And what we think could happen is that lots of people could take pride in what they do. And if they did, it would almost change them as people. And we are very close to that. It wouldn't be hard to do. If we did it, we could have a much better country.
Solutions will not happen overnight. In this series, we will look at the future that awaits us. We will look at problems and solutions. For example, in tape 4, we will look in more detail at the work pursuit lifestyle discussed by Bergman. And in tape 5, we will discuss the type of education that will prepare students for future work. The technological revolution that is taking place presents the possibility to live life to its fullest. We are on the brink of realizing this potential. This series should be one of celebration. In the first part of this tape, we will look at the problems and changes taking place in the auto industry. The auto industry is far from being the only industry undergoing transformation. Technology is changing all of manufacturing, whether it is for cars, TVs, or refrigerators. We will use the auto industry as simply one example of a rapidly changing industry. In the second part of this tape, we will explore some possible solutions to the problems facing the auto industry. Let us start by taking an honest look at our current situation, as unsettling as it may seem. Most people want to blame robotics for the layoffs in the auto industry. But as UAW member Mike Westfall will explain, there are many contributing factors besides robotics.
Many people feel that technology is the only problem that we're facing. But that just isn't the case. What we're seeing is technology is one element of the restructuring equation. We're seeing that technology in the form of robotics, of integrated systems, of storage facilities is one element. Another element is outsourcing, where so many of our jobs now are being shipped to other countries. And many of these workers are being paid very low wages, and they're being, in fact, they're being exploited. And then they're being used against us as unfair competitive examples. There's no way that we can compete with these people that make $2 an hour or less. It would just be financial suicide for us to even try. Another strategy that we're facing that is equally important to automation is downsizing. We've already seen substantial downsizing in our vehicles. We're going to see more. The elimination of the frame alone has already cost us 3,000 jobs. When you downsize, the once popular V8 has been replaced by the now popular four-cylinder, where there's a lot fewer manufacturing processes. You use a lot less steel, a lot less glass, a lot less synthetic rubber, and all the other materials that go into it. You have fewer manufacturing processes in the body side panels. You use smaller tires. Also, another restructuring strategy that we're facing that is very critical is composite materials. And when we talk composite materials, we're talking the new plastics that are coming on stream. We see them in the body of the new Fiero, Pontiac Fiero. We see them in the fiberglass leaf springs on the Corvette. We see them in the hoods and in the trunks of many of the new cars. In the future, they're coming out with plastic motors. They're coming out with plastic wheels. Basically, the entire vehicle, from drivetrain to body components, will be composite materials or plastics. And we also see the restructuring going on in areas such as the delivery systems of material to the assembly plants, where material comes directly from supplier plants to assembly plants in a system they call Kanban, which knocks out the storage plants in between. And this also reduces the working conditions in the plant to somewhere below pitiful, because you're always out of material. They no longer want you to have a lot of material in the plant.
Both management and workers understand that work cannot stay the same in the auto industry. But as you will see, there are different viewpoints about the future changes.
Companies are going to be leaner. They're going to be reducing their white-collar force, as Ford and GM have already announced they plan to do in the next couple of years. And they will be producing the same or more automobiles with less manpower, both white-collar and blue-collar, and particularly as technology eats into jobs in both the white-collar and blue-collar occupations.
In Lansing, At Oldsmobile, they have robots now. No truck drivers. The trucks all move out automatically, and stock goes from here to there, and no one even touches it. But for the most part, we don't know anything. No one has made much effort to educate the people on the line, at least. There may be a few in the people in the upper echelons of labor or management that are aware, but as far as we know, there won't be any changes at all. I mean, they haven't told us about any to speak of.
By 1990, GM alone plans to purchase upwards of 20,000 robots. And many believe this 20,000 figure is light because it was a figure developed in the midst of the worst economic depression in memory. But GM can certainly deal with job figures, with figures that deal with job displacements. And according to one friend of mine from MIT, who has a document on GM's figures, says that the robots currently installed in their assembly plants have displaced 1.7 workers per robot. And that's the net figure after you factor in the number of people that install the technology and maintain it. In GM manufacturing plants, the displacement is 2.7 workers per robot on a multi-shift operation. So on this one technology, the tip of the technological iceberg, we're talking about the loss of 40 to 50,000 jobs at General Motors alone.
We hear right now at our plant that our jobs will be shifted to other plants because our plant is not automated like these other plants. So we will lose our jobs eventually in our plant because our plant is not competitive right now.
Many people feel that robots are somewhat limited to painting and are limited to welding. And historically, they were. At first, they came in only to the hot, hazardous, dangerous jobs. Then they came in, and they changed the definition to boring and monotonous. Now, the robots are coming on to some of the better jobs in the plant, such as inspection. There's already a robot that's developed that has four legs and walks. And they're working on one with six legs and walks that does linear inspections. One robot system that was just developed out of Massachusetts puts together all 17 parts of the alternator.
And people in Michigan are gradually beginning to sort of chew on this and take it in and are trying to swallow it, and it's not an easy pill to swallow, but it will never again go back to what it was, the car industry. And of course, lots of people have said that in some sense or other, every sixth job in this country depends on, has some connection now to the car industry.
We need to sound an alarm nationally. We need to take and let the people know that they're in the positions in this country that can institute social change, that we need social change. We need to let them know that the people that are now working, many, many of them are going to be displaced. That the generation that follows these people, unless we take and do something, that there could very well become a lost generation.
Our futures are very uncertain at this point, and we do have a great concern for our children. Already this day and age, a lot of our families have suffered. We have to compete for the jobs. And in the future, I think we'll have to be real competitive to get a job that now, at this point in time, is fairly easy to get.
At Jefferson Avenue plant, they had 98 different classifications. Classification, by classification, I mean maybe I'm classified as a repair person or an inspector. Okay, what they do is they come along and on the job that I've done, they say to me that, now I want you, the operator of the job, to check your own parts. Okay, you
check your own parts.
Yes, yeah. It starts out as just do me a favor, okay, supervisor. And you stand there with a piece of chalk or something, and you know, everybody's into, you know, wanting to get good quality out. You know, we're all being bombarded with this quality of work life stuff, you know, and you want to get out good quality, and you know, everybody's afraid that if I don't do my part, you know, we're all going to lose our jobs, and that's the only reason we're losing them is because we're not doing our part. So you say, okay, but what you don't realize is that when you check the part yourself, that then they don't need an inspector. then eventually they come along and they say, well, we find that this little thing here is wrong, and if you'll take this tool and put this screw in a little bit tighter or something, that's better. What you don't realize is that that job was being done by someone classified as a repair person. So pretty soon, you wind up with a situation like you had at Jefferson Avenue, Chrysler plant, where they go from 98 classifications down to 10, which really, in effect, means that what they've done is taken the work that for example, inspectors and repair people were doing, and put that on the job of the machine operator, right, or the assembler.
Right.
And there's no need then for the repairman and the inspector. Those are two jobs that are gone. These are the kinds of things that people are experiencing in,
right,
the plant that know, that make us know, right, that there will be no jobs there for our children.
I've heard the term revolution used by both the speakers today, and I guess I use it to you, and I would ask the two speakers today, you know, where is that revolution? That revolution has to happen at both ends of the ladder. Has to happen at the top, at the highest ranks of the UAW. It has to happen at the highest ranks of General Motors, and it has to happen at the lowest end of the hierarchy of both structures, and work its way up and work its way down. If that don't happen, there can be no survival.
It's the most natural thing in the world for management to soft pedal this, to be evasive, to say, oh yes, but you know, we'll increase the automation, but everybody will keep their job. We'll move some people from here to there.
Can I ask you, it might sound like a dumb question, what does it feel like to be unemployed?
It feels very frightening. Now, I can tell you that at one time I can believe that it wasn't so bad to be unemployed, if you remember the UAW, you know, because the UAW fought very hard to make sure that there were some means of surviving during periods of unemployment. But we're in a whole different situation now, because we're in a period of unemployment now that is permanent. You know, it's a period of unemployment where I can't say, well, my unemployment and sub-benefits will carry me through this. I already experienced that in 81, where all of that ran out. It's very frightening to be unemployed, because I don't know what's out there for me now. I'm hearing that we have all these wonderful job training programs, and you know, you'll be retrained, and you'll have the right to do this and the right to do job training for what? For what job? What job? You know, I'm hearing a lot of people talking about what the problems are. And, oh, we've got a lot to worry about, because we are expecting massive unemployment in this country. And but nobody seems to have any solutions to the problem, you know. And I have no choice but to see that there's something wrong in our system, that I am a 45-year-old mother with five children who has worked all of her life. I've worked since I was 11 or 12 years old, who is willing to work. And now I'm frightened that there's not a job there for me.
The companies have been totally restructuring from the ground up, and that the net end result is going to be long-term, permanent, probably, in many instances, unemployment, which is going to funnel out into the community. Because when people like me don't work, I can't support the hardware store and the television store and the plumber. And what we're dealing with, it's not even, it even transcends auto. It goes into the community. It's a national problem. Because what's happening now in auto is going to happen in every manufacturing industry across the nation.
As mentioned earlier, we are losing jobs because of new technologies such as robotics and restructuring of manufacturing. In addition to this, many jobs are being sent overseas through what is known as outsourcing, or simply sourcing.
You look at Chrysler, who's 70% purchased, and he did that very nicely. He gave the union AIF last contract and said, I keep the right to source. He now makes 30% of his car and sources 70 out. It gives him a $600 cost advantage over General Motors. This guy's no dummy. Ford's following the same practice, and he's getting close to doing the same thing. And I think General Motors and the union are going to have to jointly address the component plants.
GM is in 40 different countries. Ford, they're in over 31. And when you talk about, people say, well, what's wrong with these auto companies moving to these foreign countries? Well,
There's absolutely nothing wrong with them moving to these foreign countries. If they, in fact, paid a respectable wage, but they don't. They exploit these people with shamefully low wages and then use them as unfair competitive examples of how American workers are overpaid and underworked.
In the United States, the average manufacturing wage is $13.09 an hour. In Mexico, the average manufacturing wage is $1.07 an hour. In South Korea, the average manufacturing wage is $1.55 an hour. In Japan, the average manufacturing wage is $9.50 an hour. In Taiwan, the average manufacturing wage is $1.71 an hour. In Brazil, the average manufacturing wage is $1.28 an hour.
I've talked with and been at conferences and with people that are from foreign countries. In June of 81, I was at an 18-nation conference, and all the workers, there was workers from 18 different nations, and all those workers were General Motors workers. And those men had tears in their eyes. One man was from Brazil. His name was Francisco Marcos Jr. And he said that the Brazilian wage rate for General Motors was $1.80 per hour. And he got upset because some of the people there were talking. He says, I want you to know what it's like to make $1.80 an hour. It inspires religious belief because only God knows how a man can support his family on $1.80 an hour.
It was just an observation of mine that I was thinking one day, so many of the workers on the rivet line, people I work with, my co-workers, are from Bay City and Saginaw, plants that have closed down up there. And they've all come to work in the truck plant here in Flint. And now, in order for me to keep working, I have to move 60, 40 miles south, whatever it is. And the people from Saginaw and Bay City will probably be the last. This will be their burial spot, you know. Maybe Pontiac will be mine. And maybe 5 years from now, they'll move us all from Pontiac down to Fort Wayne. And, you know, it's just a continual, you know, migration towards the south. And, of course, I took it to the extreme by saying we're all going to end up in a mass burial pit in Mexico by the mid-1990s, but...
You think that's about the right time schedule?
The way things are going, what was it in the paper the other day, you know, the three shops here in Flint, you know, to be mothballed here pretty quick, you know, you can only expect that there's going to be more in the coming years. So it seems like they're all fleeing south. They're definitely getting out of this town.
The future may sound pretty grim. However, there are solutions to some of the problems. Some say we need to look at government solutions, such as laws that would keep manufacturing in this country.
Right now, let's not kid anyone, what's happening is the huge corporations here, they're not shipping those goods in. Our corporations are going over and purchasing them to bring them in, because why pay the American worker whatever amount of dollars, whether it be $11 an hour or whatever, and with benefits more than that, when they can run over to Mexico at all the way from 68 cents an hour to Taiwan and those places. They're going to do that. Now, Germany, Italy, France, England, all of them, they don't allow the corporations to do that like they do here.
What are some of the things that you think are going on that people should know about?
Well, number one, like I say, it is devastating the way that the good jobs are leaving. And the way they cover that up is by saying, oh, yes, but we've created this many more, thousands more jobs. But they're creating them part-time at McDonald's and those type places. And a good example is the company I just mentioned, employs more people, McDonald's employs more people than anyone else in the United States. But the difference is, that's that minimum wage with no benefits versus all of our industrial jobs is disappearing from these shores, you know. And I'll guarantee you one thing. You can't keep up the hospitals, the schools, and the roads on taxes off the people working at McDonald's.
Whether or not we can keep jobs in this country, we are going to have to restructure the jobs that remain. Some of the forms this could take are flex time, job sharing, parental leaves, and sabbaticals.
You asked me about, you know, what kind of future do we perceive. I think that ultimately it comes down is this industrial revolution we're going through, we're going to have to see a shorter work week in this country. Mm-hmm. And it's going to have to take shape in many forms. It can be flex time. It could be job sharing. It could be parental leaves, which Sweden and our closest neighbor Canada has parental leaves in which the women can take as much as 41 weeks off with approximately 60% of their pay. And seeing how women are 50% of the workforce in today's society, you can see that's a significant avenue to open up and create new jobs. There's West Germany, just their IG Metall, which is their metal workers union, they just recently negotiated a 38.5-hour week. Mm-hmm. Official statistics from the government of West Germany state that having going to a 38.5-hour week resulted in creating 80,000 jobs in mm-hmm. West Germany mm-hmm. in the metalworking industry. That is possible, number one, because technology has created the productivity and increased the output to the point to where we should derive some type of leisure from that productivity, and that's one thing they've looked at.
The idea right. behind a sabbatical is that you do some real work while you have time off.
Yeah.
Does that sort of scheme make sense to you?
You know, definitely in the factories. Many people in our factories begin with they're very, very well educated.
Mm-hmm.
You're not talking about the factory workers or the immigrants of the 30s and 40s. We're talking about people who come up through the education system of the 50s and 60s, in which we have a good education system in this country. And they're very intelligent. Many of them have college education.
That's right.
And it would be very beneficial for the person who says, let's say he has 20 years. Maybe he's a photographer. Maybe he does woodworking. Maybe he does has tremendous mechanical skills or computer skills or robotic skills.
Mm-hmm.
Many of these people, if they could take a sabbatical, they may go out and find new employment for themselves in what maybe was only a hobby, but now will have actual employment opportunities. And
technology is coming in. Robotics, all sorts of new technology. It's taken our jobs. Now, in turn, I feel as a worker, this technology should also fund benefits for us, job-creating type benefits, earlier retirements, if that's what it takes, whatever it takes, flex time, shorter work week.
Somebody in this country is responsible for seeing that people work. And there's so many things that are needed in this country. There's no excuse for people being unemployed. I think that one of the things, I have no doubt that workers will rise to the occasion, that people know that they deserve to have jobs, particularly people like myself who have been in the workforce, who have made a decent wage and that understand what our union history and heritage is. You know, I have no doubt in my mind that we will rise to the occasion and demand jobs for ourselves. What will have to take place in order for the jobs to be there, I don't know. But I guess the fear is that I don't want to see people like myself who were people who thought they were the so-called middle class, who really wound up finding out that all we really had going for us was a job, and that all it took to take that away from us is a pink slip. And along with the pink slip goes the standard of living. Along with the pink slip goes the American dream. Along with the pink slip goes the dignity and the pride in being able to be one's own person because one is taking care of oneself. And there are many people like me out here, you know, who are going to realize that. I know that I'm going to fight for my job, and I know that many people like me are going to fight for their job.
Right now, it sounds like a very radical concept, but I think that the times are going to dictate that it's not as radical as it sounds. I think that everything that we have been saying, I know in my movement and in what you have been saying, are going to come at us very quickly. They are already coming at us, and that people are going to become aware that it's either do something like this or they're not going to have any livelihood.
We're living in an exciting time, I feel. We're going to see some very innovative and structural changes in this society for the good. probably by the late 1990s. I don't know how we could possibly avoid it.
As you can see, the auto industry is not what it used to be. In this tape, we have presented some solutions. Clearly, we are going to have to make changes if we want decent jobs in the future. Many people say we are in a transition from manufacturing to service. What they mean is that although jobs in manufacturing are being eliminated, the gap is being filled by new jobs created in the service sector. However, technology is eliminating jobs in the service sector and professions as well. The idea of a transition from one area of work to another is not new. There was a major transition from agriculture to manufacturing at the turn of this century.
It used to be that there were about 95% of all the people, were 90, or somewhere around there, worked on farms. And 90% working on farms created enough surplus so that about 10% could live in the cities and could live on the surplus that was produced by 90% that all lived on farms. Well, in the last 150 years or so, we turned this upside down. In fact, we did more than turn it upside down. If you check right now, it's only about 3% that can produce all the food, all the tomatoes, all the corn, all the zucchinis, all the flour that we use, and all of the rest, 97%, can live off that. If you want to have an example of what technology can do, then that's an example. Now, a few machines manage to drive all of those people off their land. A few machines can, with a few people, can produce enough food. Now, there's an example of what technology can do. But that's still not the whole picture. The picture should go on like this. Yeah. That what really happened is that to begin with, people mostly worked in agriculture. Then technology invaded agriculture, and people were, so to say, moved out of agriculture. They were like refugees. They were like displaced persons. They went from agriculture into manufacturing. And they got some rest, so to say, in manufacturing. But then technology moved from agriculture into manufacturing and drove them out of manufacturing. Where did they go then? They went into what we call service. Service jobs. That's what people are talking about. And there are two points of analysis. One is sitting in the back of the room, or sitting at the beginning. All of the kind of automation that is coming now is coming down on service. So in a way, this is the beleaguered territory. We have moved here to here to here, and now it's coming down here. The next question is, and you should ask yourself that question, maybe we can talk about it afterwards. What comes after service? It's not obvious that there is a third, that there is still another category. People say, well, of course there will be jobs. Well, ask yourself, what jobs?
In one of the first groups of students with whom professors were in the Gold Medal, we brainstormed ideas of technology to change services and eliminate jobs.
Lots of people, they associate automation with glamorous things. No. They think of this already very, very high tech. They think of our factories of the future, of everybody in white coats with the clipboard standing around, nobody in the factory. That's what they have. I think that's very, it's almost dangerous. It gives people the idea
that automation is far away, is in the future, isn't really going to get us. And actually, in some ways, it's just the opposite.
Directly on record. And the same thing could be used with much difficulty, because present technology
let's go on from there too. I mean, sometimes we talk all about maintenance.
It's one thing. There will always be lots of repairs on top of the maintenance.
Let's talk about robots.
Supermarkets and retail stores.
Right now, you have ticker tape on those buildings in the city. They have to understand about different prices. They can just run it across the ticker tape. But maybe someone can go on back to the money cards, place them by the money cards and machines and check out their own groceries. And be taking them directly from their bank account. And so this would possibly be being used.
Like, has anybody seen that?
Yeah, you can see it in the grocery stores. These zebra stripes that they use, where they just run the prices over zebra stripes, and then it automatically goes into the cash register. And it's just a way, you know, it's just automating it. And then about security. Some people would want to raid the grocery store and, you know, take boxes of cereal and things like that. But then in the malls now, we see the racks that they have above the doorways, which I guess have metal strippings. I'm not really sure. And there's something in the actual price tag that if you would walk under that without having it run through one of these machines, the alarms go off, you know, 25 bells. And, you know, so that's a way to sort of give some security to this new system.
What did the zebra stripes tell us? They don't just tell us the price. They keep track of inventory, don't they?
Mm-hmm. So that would cut out the people who have to do that as well.
What about putting things on shelves? No? Is that the sort of thing that could be automated, and how could that be done?
Well, really, it could be done with robots who are programmed to take certain places, open them, and empty them onto a certain shelf. So that it required no human help at all.
I mean, the idea is that, yes, there might be many more retail businesses, but probably there will be fewer people inside of the retail stores. I mean, sort of the big picture is that
We might have many more self-service stores like we have right now, self-serve gas stations. And you might have, and you know, that's not very much in the future, you know, self-checkout counters where you do your own checking out of your own groceries. You know. That's an easy thing to do. And
even restaurant jobs, on which a tremendous number of Americans depend for their income, could become automated.
There's some computerizing of, say, like the orders. Like you walk into your fast food restaurant and you tell them you want two hamburgers, and rather than having the person turn around and yell into the back, they just punch it in on a computer, which then puts it back on like a screen in the back so the cook can do it, you know, can do see what to do. And it also helps to keep like the inventory, and it's added up right away for the person rather than them having to do it themselves. So it makes it a lot more efficient and faster than it would be before.
So some places, you know, such as smorgasbord restaurants, you know, you have where the table rotates and people just come up and pick whatever they would like, you know, or choose to eat on different things. And this is not really all in the future. It's happening right now where you just walk up and choose anything you would like. And, you know, this does away with a lot of the low-skilled jobs, too.
You can't expect when you're in high school, well, I'm going to go work at, you know, some fast food restaurant, you know, when I graduate or whatnot. Because with technology being as it is, those jobs are slowly diminishing. So I think that's forcing kids into thinking about college.
One thing to say about fast food is that it could be automated away. There's probably only a social and an economic reason why it isn't automated away. It would put too many people out of work. As we sometimes say in talks, if a robot can put together automatically an automotive distributor, which is complicated, it could fry a hamburger or warm up a pizza, which is much easier.
This new technology can be a two-edged sword. When you eliminate boring work by using innovative methods, you may eliminate a job. This is as true in the professions as in other work.
Because the fact that not only the jobs that are low-skill jobs and sometimes low-wage jobs are changing or being automated. I mean, the better way of thinking about it is that all of work, you know, all jobs are changing. And it's not just automation that is changing. It's all sorts of other things as well that are going into it. But the phrase that helps is to think in terms of a transformation of work, you know, that there's a transformation of all jobs going on. No kind of job is not changing. But you know, one of the things we could talk about is ways in which the jobs that some people think of as high-class jobs, prestigious jobs, you know, the professions, how the professions are changing right now. And we could start, for example, by talking about medicine. I mean, what are some of the ways in which medicine right now, partly because of automation, but also because of other things, is now undergoing a kind of transformation?
There's also the original diagnosis of the disease, which relates to the technicians, but a lot of the new automation can help the computers.
How does that work?
Well, what happens is types of diseases are entered into a computer, and they're listed by symptoms. So a doctor, if he's not sure, he'll list the symptoms of what the patient has, the fever, the different types of blood levels. He'll put that in there, and the computer will give him an answer on every type of possible disease that could match that scenario.
What sort of new jobs will be coming into medicine? Now, what sort of things will people do in medicine that they didn't used to do? And what sort of education will those jobs need? The new jobs in medicine that are coming in. Do you have any thoughts about that?
Yeah, I think you're going to have a rise in like nursing homes.
Right.
Like, say 20, 30 years ago, they didn't have many of those around. But now that you're finding that since people want to get out of the hospital as soon as possible because it's expensive, they get into these nursing homes and they're taken better care of there until they can get into their own house. And you also see like they have meals on wheels, things like that. But also, I think that eventually will be like nurses on wheels, sort of, where the nurse will be able to go to like the house and look in on the patient several times daily so that they can stay in the home rather than having to even go to a nursing home.
Right. I mean, one of the things that links up with, you know, is that one of the biggest changes that's happening in the country is that people are living longer. You know? And you can think of that So if that's one of the tremendous accomplishments, it's a terrific achievement. No? But that also means that people know we will have a great increase of people, older people, and they will require all sorts of care. Now, there will be a great number of people above 65. So one kind of thing that will happen is that there are lots more nursing homes. But what else happens with people? You know, what else can you sort of think of that might be needed as jobs for people, for the many, many people that are over 65? Yes, Tom?
So many people over 65, I think you'd have more physical therapists, people who would, right. Well, when you get to a certain age, and usually most people over 65 are retired, I don't know if that situation will change in their future, but they have nothing to do, and the time, there's no time to take up, so I think they'll have more people with more, say, education, educating older people. Might have dance classes for people over 50, or a music class for people over 50. I think it's going to be more, what do you call that, octogenarian healthcare, or whatever that is called.
Mm-hmm. There will be jobs for people who, let's say, can teach dancing, or for people who can teach aerobic exercises, or for people who can do physical therapy, or for people who can teach painting to older people. All of these things. Now, there will be jobs, but the idea is you will have to know something in order to get that kind of job. You'll have to have the skills, the education.
Law, engineering, and business are changing too.
I think that one of the major increases of uses of computers and automation will be in the service of law itself.
Right, I think that's important.
Because the hardest thing about being a lawyer is being able to assimilate all the facts and all the current laws and keeping them updated. But with a computer, all you have to enter in is a basic fact, and it'd give you all the background cases you would need and all the relevant laws. So that'd make being a lawyer a lot simpler task.
Right. I mean, actually, I'm not sure it makes it a harder task, because the idea is that the simple part of being a lawyer, you know, if all you know is a few laws and a few, if all you can do is look things up, well, probably a computer can do that as well as you. So, you know, to be a successful lawyer, you have to be able to do more than that. What about engineering? You know, a lot of people think that, well, you know, if you are in the engineering school, so to say, you are safe. You're like on a lifeboat or something. How do you think
about that? Well, there are many advances being made in the drawings, in drawing different products, and we've also moved up to using computers to design rather than pencils or pencil, what have you.
That's a real important point. I mean, that computers can do a tremendous amount of what goes into designing. Computers can do three-dimensional modeling, so that a lot of the time that used to go into having to actually make a model and then try it out and see how it would function under this kind of circumstance, under this kind of stress, all of that you can do by pushing a few buttons. What about, you know, executives and middle management? Richard, do you want to get us into that?
Well, with computers coming in, executives can be more efficient. And I've read where maybe one executive could do the job of four executives once automation comes in at the office level, much more than it is right now.
In general, I think it's going to sort of cut out the middleman, and it's going to make things are going to be able to be done quicker and more efficiently.
If you read the newspapers, you can see that in almost every industry, you know, not just in cars, but all over the place, no matter what you look at, there are great layoffs or early retirements or things like this, and you know, all kinds of different ways of moving people out of their jobs. And those are people who have had very good jobs, you know, very high salaries, you know, middle management, executive people. And some of it just has to do with the fact that, you know, the way it used to be is that there was a plant manager, and that plant manager sort of collected the information about that plant. And then from that plant, the information was relayed on to the headquarters of the organization. Let's say in the case of cars, usually Detroit. Well, now you don't need a plant manager to collect the information. You can send, you know, using more automation, you can get the information directly to Detroit. And they can look at a console and see what's going on at all the different plants all over the
world. What that means is that there'll be a whole lot less traveling. I mean, you see executives traveling back and forth on airplanes with their briefcases and attaché cases, and there's not going to be as much of that. There'll be more teleconferencing. There'll be more plans that are just automatically transmitted by computer.
I think that many of the executives we're going to get hired now are going to have, like as you said, a wider base of education and of experiences, rather than having one guy who knows how to do one thing and have him as an executive. You know, he's risen up through the ranks and stuff. You're going to have somebody now who knows how to do several different things, so he can take the place of two or three other people that before only knew how to do one thing. They're going to try to streamline their companies, get their executives to do more than they used to do before.
Somehow everyone's job will be affected. The ideas that we have presented so far about the future of work are disturbing. You may wonder what jobs are out there for you. The point of these tapes is not to strike panic, but to confront what is happening so that you can prepare yourself for a changing work world. Tape, we are going to look at the solutions being proposed by the Center for New Work. Specifically, a plan that consists of working at a job for 6 months of the year and at a pursuit for the other 6 months of the year. We will explain the details of this plan and focus on its advantages. To understand our present work situation, let's step back and look at the big picture.
One of the first definitions of freedom among the Greeks was to be free from work, to not have to work. And the idea is that what we did is that after a very, very long time of doing relatively little, as little as we could get away with, and work was sort of despised. Nobody thought it was wonderful to work. Everybody was sane and realized it was pretty awful. So you did as little as possible, but at the end of it, partly under the influence of the industrialization, but under the influence of all kinds of things, including, of course, the Protestant ethic, we went a little crazy, and we started to work harder and more until we sort of reached 12 hours and 14 hours and 16 hours of work. But the important point to keep in mind is that all of this happened only roughly maybe 300 years ago, 200 years ago, in terms of the whole of human history. That's practically nothing.
With industrial development, work peaked at around 14 hours a day. However, in the last several decades, the number of hours that people work a day has declined.
We've historically seen a trend toward less and less work by people. You know, in my great-grandfather's day, people worked 12 hours a day when they had a job, and this was expected. In my grandfather's day, it went down to 10. In my father's day, it went down to 8. Fine, maybe this generation can take it down to 4. Or maybe we can find a completely different style, which is what Fridtjof and Dick have been talking about, working part of the year on a job and then working another part of the year doing something else that you enjoy doing. This is a birth of freedom. This is not anything we should be afraid of. The disaster will be if we don't adapt to it.
The job place has been an alienating experience, but I think what's exciting now is that it is finally in history. I think we have a possibility to change that for the first time. I don't think before we've had the material conditions where we can make the workplace more fulfilling for everyone. I think that's also a change that is taking place right now and is much more exciting.
How is that taking place?
I think the technological revolution is a big part of that. It eliminates a lot of the backbreaking menial labor that has been done traditionally by people. It allows the production of materials by a fewer quantity of people. This way, the larger groups of people are allowed time to do what they like while the machines produce more things.
8-hour workday has been in effect for, 40, 50 years. And what with automation and the new high tech that's coming in, profits are going up and up with the price of labor in an automobile going down and down.
Right now. Yeah.
But yes, that isn't it about time that we work less time?
Why not use this new technology to work less? If you could have a secure part-time job and be able to do something that you really want to do during the rest of your time, wouldn't you just jump at the offer? Well, This basically is the Center for New Work's plan for the future. We refer to the solution proposed by the Center for New Work as the six-month solution. The idea is that for 6 months of the year, you would work at a job, and for the other 6 months, you would have what we call a pursuit or new work. The pursuit would be something that you really want to do. It would mean going back to school, starting a business, working on your home, or something else that you have dreamed of doing. If everyone did this, many jobs would be opened up and there would be less unemployment. The plan could also take different forms, such as 3 months on the job, 3 months off, or even a shorter work week.
Have people work in larger chunks, and then have large chunks of free time. Have 6 months of fairly intensive work, and then have 6 months of job free time. Or have a whole year of fairly intensive work, and then have a whole year of job free time. Or have 3 months, 3 months, or 3 years, 3 years. There are all kinds of variations on this, but the basic idea is to push it together, to not have little bits of work and little bits of leisure. The most basic, the most obvious advantage would be that if we had larger chunks of free time, we could put it to some use. What is happening now? The business of having people go off work, then have a little bit of free time, go off work, and work, and then a little bit of free time. It's like what psychologists do to rats. It drives people crazy. It's no surprise that, you know, there's nothing that one can do with a weekend in this sort of situation. But if you had 3 months, or if you had 6 months, well, that would be time to do something productive, to do something worthwhile, to do something that might make life cheaper, better, more worthwhile. Now, of course, the big next question is, well, if we do have work in these compressed parts, and if we do have free time in larger chunks, what will people do in the larger chunks of free time? And the one thing I would want to get away from is the idea that it would be leisure. It would not be leisure. And the word I've been using for what people would do in the long stretches of free time is they would have pursuits. One of the things we have been pushing for is simple. It's just to get rid of a kind of craziness. It's crazy for people to have to work more than they want to work if other people don't have any work at all. So what we've been saying is, let people work less, give them a choice, let them work less, and in the rest of the time, let them do something they really want to do. Let them have a pursuit.
I think what most of us are seeking is greater independence. We know that you have to work for a living at doing something. But what kind of occupation or profession will give you the greatest amount of freedom? That's what most of us seek. We want to have some kind of feeling of self-worth. That is, by doing something that seems to be an expression of ourselves.
Even during good times, when we've been able to work with full employment, 30 people work 30, 35 years, and they work 50, 60 hours a week and so forth. I'm, in my own mind, I'm not so sure that that's the best way to live one's life anyway, because I think there's more to life than going in and committing yourself, your whole self, to a job continually, 10, 12 hours a day, 6, 7 days a week, 52 weeks a year. There's more to life to enjoy. People have families. They need to share time with their families. They need to develop a full, what I call, quality of living, which consists of more than working 7 days a week, 10 or 12 hours a day. Now, it's going to be hard for people, particularly in Flint, perhaps, to break some of those habits that we've had in the past of working those kinds of hours. But the very fact that those kinds of opportunities are not going to exist anymore is going to have to help in that regard. But people are going to have to learn to do other things. We're going to have to learn new job opportunities. We're going to have to learn new skills. We're going to have to learn to do other things. And I quite frankly think that maybe we'll begin to enjoy life a little more. Maybe we will begin to to appreciate life a little better than perhaps we have in the past.
Actually, there are people who already are living this sort of plan. Betty Ann Shankar used to be a full-time teacher. She now works part-time and writes in the rest of her time.
I think it's fantastic. I would never go back to a full-time job. And the fact is that a lot of the worries and concerns that I had once, and that many of my friends still have until I start telling them what to do, never materialized. Money, well, how could I possibly live on less money? Well, it turns out that, for one thing, working costs money. I spend far less money on clothes, transportation, upkeep of all kinds. So although in a way I live on less money, I have just the same amount. And then I think it's just the freedom it has given me. I like to write, and that's really my love. So now I can write. I work much harder, with much more concentration for the short hours, even the fundraising job, which I can do. I can work till midnight or 1 or 2 o'clock in the morning if I want to, 2 days a week. But there I'm fully concentrated. I'm really giving them my worth, their money's worth. But also the other one. Whereas before, like with teaching, even though I liked it and I thought I was doing a good job, I was exhausted. You know, half the time I was only half there and I couldn't help it. It wasn't like I didn't want to. I simply couldn't do it.
In 1982, at the AC spark plug plant in Flint, three women came up with the idea of sharing their jobs.
Job sharing would be an ideal thing for me and for Dion. Dion would like to go to Florida in the wintertime, and I like my summers and my spring and my fall off. So the two of us would job share. I would work the spring, summer, and fall, and she would...
You'd work the winter months, and I would work the summer months.
Mm-hmm. And I would have my spring, summer, and fall, and she would have her winter to go to Florida.
Would that represent less money for you and your husband?
I believe so. I would volunteer to just take the leave and not have to worry about any salary.
I mean, you would be willing to take whatever cut in pay that would mean. If you worked half time, half of your income, that would be fine with you.
That would be fine with me.
Claude works on the line at GM, but he also has opened a studio in which he gives yoga classes.
I felt like it was important for me to to have some sense of self-worth in life. And the way I do that is by having some sort of an occupation or an avocation that I really enjoy doing, that I can feel comfortable with, that is helping me as a person, but also one where I'm contributing to the lives of other people in society. And so I bought this commercial building down here in this blighted area, and it was cheap, and I started having yoga classes here. And to me, it's been a really rewarding experience.
It is this sort of side interest or hobby that could become your pursuit in the six-month plan.
Dan has a snow plowing business. He's always trying to create new ideas that will make more money for him. I know another young man who's in the video business, and he does that on the side. Some people make union buttons and sell them even, all kinds of things.
These people are enthusiastic about the changes of work in their lives. In fact, there are a whole range of advantages of the six-month solution for management, workers, and society. We'd like to spell these advantages out for you. There are a variety of advantages for management. For example, the plan would reduce absenteeism, reduce medical costs, and reduce burnout, and increase productivity.
One of the things now that IBM does and Kodak does, it gives people what they call social service leaves, where you can go for 1 year and work on something, and then you can come back to your job. And they do it because it improves their morale, it reduces burnout, it reduces absenteeism, and God knows what. So, I mean, part of the idea is that what one would do is just give, instead of one social service leave, would give a social service leave sort of on a regular basis to the people who are working.
So many people today are saying they're bored with their jobs, and I firmly believe that it's a good possibility that there would be a lot less absenteeism if people were to job share.
Well, it's supported by statistics where this has been used.
One could think of a personnel department of a corporation thinking that, well, what we have to do is not just give them small benefits while they work, but actually arrange it so that part of the time they work and the rest of the time they can do something that is more meaningful, that they find more fulfilling, that really they find a sort of uplift, you know, between the times in which they work, so that we can use the time between work as a kind of thing that will give them incentive, that will motivate, that we as personnel managers can use in order to attract better people, to recruit better people, and ultimately to make the corporation that we work for more profitable.
Also, the six-month plan would be advantageous for management because it would increase their market. In addition, since the plan would promote and heighten cooperation between labor and management, this would speed up the introduction of new technology.
Workers who have a sense of security about their jobs are much more likely to be accepting of that new technology, new organizations of work. They feel they've got a stake in the corporation as it is now. And I think we witnessed this in Flint when people didn't want to give up overtime. It's get as much as I can now because I have no idea what the future's going to be like.
Yeah.
And one thing that does strike me, insofar as you've negotiated job security, the worker then has a stake in the corporation. And that brings about a very different psychology, I think, on the part of the workers.
Lastly, this plan would give management an edge in world competition. The idea behind this is that a happier workforce will be more productive. Besides these advantages for management, there are many advantages for workers. For one, it would increase workers' sense of security.
I would be very happy to see that you and Richard succeed in your proposal for getting less hours. If you can do that with adequate compensation and somehow give us an opportunity to cultivate our personal lives more, give us some direction. I think we need more than just the opportunity to not work as much. We need some sort of direction and something that will give us a sense of security.
Another advantage for workers is more freedom.
This is one of the things which our country was founded on, the basis that men should be free and able to pursue.
Men and women.
Thank you.
Should be able to pursue happiness.
No, it's interesting you go back to the founding fathers. And you know, the idea is that there was a lot of talk about freedom. And, you know, we do have, you know, all these wonderful freedoms and liberties of speech, of assembly, you know, of the press, and so on. But there's a way in which, if we don't do something about work, then there's a catch there. You know, you can have all these freedoms, but you have to work 60 or 70 hours a week. And, you know, in a way, this could be a step towards getting, you know, more freedom in a really substantial way.
Free to be what you want to be. But the only difference is we're adding more time for you to do your work and also time for doing those other things that you may want to do. You know, develop your other hobbies, any dreams that you may want to have developed. In our present society, there are so many people who are just working and they don't have time to develop into certain things that they would want to be.
Workers would also be more self-sufficient.
Having, in effect, a part-time job gives you a big contribution towards self-sufficiency because you have time. I'm no builder. I have very few skills with my hands, but my wife and I managed this summer while I was working part-time to put in our mobile home on a piece of land and do all of the work ourselves except the electrical work, which neither of us had skills to do. Just having that time and the flexibility in my schedule so that I could say, all right, for the next 3 days, I'm going to work on the septic system. I do not have to go to work. That makes a big contribution toward making you more self-sufficient.
Now let's look at the advantages for society. A major advantage is that the plan would reduce unemployment.
The six-month idea, what we're talking about, is an alternative to welfare. I mean, if it really works, it should create a lot of jobs so that people can, for one thing, instead of being on welfare, have at least half a job. which we hope pays more than half as much. But then in addition to that, they would also have more opportunities to do something else, to get, you know, if there were a system of grants in place where they could get grants to do something.
Also, it would improve the quality of our lives by increasing the wealth in our country.
Making it so that most of the population in the country can live a decent kind of life, that's long-range planning. That's intelligent. You create your market that way for your goods by making sure that quite a number of people in your country live well, have decent wages, and then demand your goods. What we are doing is the opposite. Now, we are creating a situation where there will be fewer and fewer people able to buy the goods that we produce, and there will be masses of people who will be impoverished and will no longer be able to buy. And that is a sure way of ruining the country.
Finally, the plan is a step toward the resolution of other problems, such as rebuilding cities.
And the whole point is to keep in mind now that different things will work for different people. There's no one solution for everybody. But the kind of thing we're working on for Detroit is the idea that, yes, there are lots of people that are unemployed in Detroit. And what could the people who are still working in Detroit do? What could be their pursuit? But after a lot of working around, what we've come up with is the idea that what they could do is they could rebuild Detroit. But rebuild Detroit not just by painting it, no, but really rebuild Detroit drastically, rebuild Detroit in a sort of, according to entirely different concepts of what a city could be like. Part of what we're working on quite hard is the idea that you could have a city with lots of fish ponds on the rooftops. And fish ponds have been used in China for 4,000 years, and you can grow a tremendous amount of fish in a very small space, and people can eat fish instead of cat food. And they are eating cat food.
In addition, there are plans that would help the poor move towards self-sufficiency.
Our value is that unemployed people are valueless. So we set them aside. But the point is now, so we've got unemployed people, bring them into a different structure, beyond General Motors, beyond the welfare system, a new structure. And in that new structure, educate them to have new values.
Yep.
When I say become self-reliant, to rebuild a house, along with that new house comes a new feeling of worth.
How can these changes be brought about? Let's listen to some of the following ideas for change.
The shorter work week and the shorter work life is not something that's going to come in like all at once, a kind of fiat.
No, it's definitely not.
It's going to be something that's going to have to be negotiated and worked for by large unions, by small unions, by individuals.
It's going to have to be somewhat of a social movement on behalf of unions as a whole in this country. And it will not come overnight. It's going to have to be something that is going to take. I think it's going to be somewhat a political struggle, and it's going to be a collective bargaining struggle. Because some of these things have to take place at legislation.
Starting some pilot programs whereby that could in fact be demonstrated. That is, that people really are doing something productive without 6 months off. There are going to be a lot of people looking over there, looking, you know, at their neighbor and saying, gee, it looks like it might be fun. It might be better than the treadmill that I'm on.
One idea that quite a few people have been working on, that sort of fits in here is the idea of a new kind of foundation, a new foundation, where actually GM now is doing something that's a little like that, and it makes a lot of sense. The notion is that as they move in more advanced technology, they're making available, in fact right now, $100 million are available in venture capital for the people who are displaced by this technology to be able to use. You know? And sort of a general idea might be that as you put in more technology, you should put not just have more jobs, you know, but put more money into foundations so that more people could go to foundations either for a loan or for a grant to do something that they would want to do.
A tax structure might be put into place that would be advantageous for business. I read recently someone who said, well, maybe business has imaginative work schemes, that they should get tax breaks for that, that that would give them an incentive for a kind of six months. I mean, we give business tax breaks for all kinds of things.
Although you would work at a job only half of the time, you could receive 75% of your pay. According to the Center for New Work, This would be possible because in addition to receiving 50% of your annual wages, your company could contribute an additional 5% since you would be working more productively. The city could contribute 5%, the state could contribute 5%, the federal government could contribute 5%, and you could earn 5% independently as indirect income. Altogether, this comes to an additional 25%, making a total of 75% of your annual wages for 6 months of work. It is important to note that the Center for New Work is advocating that with a part-time job, you would still have benefits and insurance coverage. The underlying purpose of the solutions discussed in this program are to move people from jobs that they dislike into more meaningful endeavors that could be fruitful to them as well as society. Why are you in school? Yes, it's the law. Your parents expect it of you. You probably didn't have much choice about going to high school. This tape is about education. With the changes that are taking place in the workforce, it is more critical now than ever for students to think carefully about their education. This series has given you evidence that it is going to be tough finding jobs in the future. The goal of this tape is to help you identify the type of education that will best prepare you for future work.
We always had a theory that people I went to high school with, if we didn't want to do anything else, if we didn't want to go on for schooling or had any certain specific direction, we could always latch on to Papa GM and make a decent wage, you know, doing some unskilled labor. Those times aren't around anymore. The kids of today, the youth of Flint today, don't have that as an option. They're just not hiring anymore. I'm sort of the last of a generation, I guess.
They're still holding on to so tight the belief that I don't have to even finish high school because I can remember everybody telling me all you had to do was leave school and just go around the corner to your nearest local industrial plant and you'd have a job with great salary and great benefits. And we're still constantly fighting that's not there anymore. And people have a hard time believing that.
There was a recent study of students in the Flint area, and it was found that 40% of them still believe that they can get a job working in an auto factory when they graduate from high school.
Yeah.
So these things need to be discussed very much.
Well, if I had an opportunity to speak directly to that 40% of those students who feel that way.
In a way, you have that opportunity, right?
Okay,
now.
Well, I would tell them that that's a false sense of hope, in my opinion, that they really need to be about the business of preparing themselves to do something other than to work for General Motors and to do something perhaps other than to perhaps even be employed in the city of Flint.
You can't expect when you're in high school, I'm gonna go work at, you know, some fast food restaurant, you know, when I graduate or whatnot, because with technology being as it is, those jobs are slowly diminishing. So I think that's forcing kids into thinking about college.
Maybe we ought to spend some time talking about why this is now, and why it is that from here on in, now virtually everybody will not just have one job, but they'll have a job for a time. Then they will have to move probably to a quite different sort of job. Then they'll have to move from that to, again, a job very different. And of course, if that's the way most people will live, well, they will need a totally different mindset, a totally different education. In some sense, the worst thing to have is training in one particular little thing, because if you have that, you're asking for trouble.
Because all they have to invent is one machine that can do the thing, the one thing you can do. If they come up with one machine that can do the one thing that you can do, boom, out you go.
With all of these jobs being eliminated, you are probably wondering what options are left for you and what you can do at this point in your education to prepare yourself to find employment. Today's students will need a broad liberal education, which will allow them to work at many different jobs. In addition, many jobs will require a higher level of skills because of the sophisticated technology that is coming into the workplace.
If there is an answer to a problem, a very big part of it is much, much more education, so that more people can move into the new jobs that require more education. But if we don't do that, we'll have all of these jobs and no people, and all of these people and no jobs, and it'll be a mess.
Do you think that we're going to pass up the liberal arts education that we're getting right now into more specialized education?
Actually, I think it's moving the other way. You know, I think that, and in a way, that's what we've been saying all along. You know, that if you only know some very specialized thing, you are in trouble.
So you're saying we're getting into more liberal arts
education, okay. Because you know, it's the general things. It's knowing many different kinds of things and being able to synthesize them and integrate them. That can't be done mechanically, that can't be done by rote, that very often can't be done by a computer. If all you know is accounting, that's very, very risky, because accounting is being taken over by computers very fast. If all you know is how to do income tax returns, you're in trouble, because more and more people are using their computer to do their own income tax returns. But if now, even in business, you know, even General Motors, now there's a big push towards hiring people who have a general education. I mean, Roger Smith, the chairman of General Motors, gave a talk in Ann Arbor saying that from here on in, they would hire much more people with general education for their executives and not people with specialized education.
Skills programs at the federal level and at the state level have been criticized because they're much too narrowly focused. They're much too job specific. I mean, it would seem to be better, at least that's what people say who know something about training and retraining, if people are very literate and if they have a flexible kind of education.
I think that the continuing education aspects of what one needs to be about or one needs to do certainly is probably the most important. You cannot today go into business or into work anywhere and expect that 5 years from now you're going to be able to continue with the same level of knowledge, same skill and ability that you had 5 years prior and be able to survive. Survival in business and industry today, survival in the world today, absolutely requires one to be prepared to do something different every day of his or her life. That's not to say that you cannot develop a basic set of skills or a foundation of knowledge that you can use. Certainly that is the case. But to think that, for example, you're going to go into a GM plant and work on a production line or an assembly line and be able to continue to do that 5 years from now, that's not going to be the case. That proof is here now. Technology has changed the way that we do things. We need people who have more technical capabilities, more technical skill and ability.
The person that's right now in high school, I think they have to face up to the fact that if they don't have pretty advanced skills, and not just one skill, but maybe any number of different kinds of skills, they're going to be competing with automation, with robots. They're going to be competing with people without skills in Singapore, in Taiwan, in China, in Korea, all over the country, all over the globe, no, in South America. And there are people without skills that in those countries will work now for 15 cents an hour, for $2 a day. And in those countries, to some extent, you may even be able to live on this. But the idea is if you don't have skills, now you will compete with that. And you face a future where your wages are going to really be low. So my feeling is now people really have to get into their heads that lack of education from here on in will mean poverty.
We have looked at the importance of getting a higher education with a base of general knowledge, such as a liberal arts degree provides. You should be prepared to be flexible, because you may have to change jobs many times in your life. Besides learning specific skills, We need to uproot many of our basic attitudes on education, work, and unemployment. Uprooting our attitudes may be the hardest task we face in this whole transformation.
For the most part, we've looked at education as a way to get a job. And that's the payoff. Rather than seeing education as a way of people developing those kinds of creative skills, that in downtime, or that 6 months off, or the days off that they have, they can do something that they would find intrinsically satisfying. But it strikes me that in many ways, the educational system is an assembly line that prepares people for an assembly line. I mean, you know, the idea that 30 people want to sit in one spot and do the same thing for the same hour is really assembly line mentality. And if people are going to find that 6 months off to be satisfying, it's going to be because they have that self-reliance initiative. And I wonder whether we don't drain that kind of creativity out of kids so that by the time that they're 18, they can't think about using their time in much of in a way much other than an assembly line or it's where you're slotted into a job that's defined by something outside, just as your teachers have defined you. Now the job's going to define you. And if we're really going to prepare people for that 6 months off, they're going to have to be self-starters. And
but the school system resists
anything. No, school system
like
isn't doing anything.
That's
like
a waste of time. They consider it a waste of time.
I mean, what we need to be telling kids right now is that the school system, you know, they're going to have to start taking initiative because it isn't going to come from the school system.
Well,
and they're going to have to start looking, well, in the sense that they need to start thinking about learning as not just preparing for a job, but for making themselves creative, productive people.
Absolutely.
Through their own
initiative. Somebody made the comment about creativity. Most little children, when they start in school, are very creative,
yes,
unbelievably
yes,
so, and bright, and alert, and they're dying to learn and crush.
So,
you know, by the end of the first year, we've gotten rid of all of that.
Yeah.
The good child sits in his seat and copies stuff endlessly hour after hour. That's what we approve of. But I agree with you. It starts with education. And
the kinds of schools we used to have were perfect for manufacturing jobs because you trained people in schools that were essentially, if I may say so, pretty boring to do rote jobs, to do one thing. And above all, we trained people in being patient, and we trained people in being punctual, we trained people in putting up with a lot of stuff. That's not the situation anymore. What we now need is people with imagination. What we now need is people with initiative. What we now need is people who can think, not just to do business elsewhere, but to manufacture or to do service or to devise new ways of financing requires imagination that you don't get, if I may say so, in business school. You get it in the humanities.
The objectives of education ought to be to help students learn how to think, learn how to solve problems, learn how to be independent, learn how to study, learn how to cope, so that no matter what they meet out there, they will be able to do something about it.
What do you think about the students that will not go on to university? It's a very large percentage of students, isn't it?
They're going to need coping skills. They're going to need to know how to adapt and adjust to the periods of unemployment,
mm-hmm.
how to use their own basic initiative and basic talents to deal with life's problems. And at this point, they're not taught that in our schools. They need to be taught self-confidence and independence.
People have to become much more active rather than passive, have to take much more the initiative, certainly should move away from the idea that any company or any corporation or any employer whatsoever will take care of them for the rest of their life. Nothing like this is in the picture. I mean, people will have to, from here on in, take responsibility for themselves.
So in the school, they really should be teaching students to take more responsibility for what they're doing. They're not only their actions, but their life and preparing for the future. And it's advocated that a very low percentage of our national product goes towards research and education. That perhaps we should be putting more money into that in terms of research and how we learn and how we can learn quicker.
Oh,
and that type
yeah.
of thing. Go along with that, no doubt.
No, well, and I think not only because
because, you know, it's sort of whatever, putting butter on the bread that I have to eat. It's also that it's sort of, if you think about it, it's insane. You know, we keep talking about competing with the Japanese, and the Japanese have an educational system that makes our system look sick and silly and medieval. But they keep putting more and more money into their system. Cutting back, and we put more money into prisons and less money into education. I think that part of our, you know, political policy is flatly suicidal. You know, it's cultural suicide. We, you know, if we had any kind of sanity at all, we would, you know, put massive money into education and take it away from things where it's obviously not being used well. And I would say defense is one part where it's not being used well. We should take massive amounts of money away from defense and put it into education, but there are also any number of other sources, places where we are splurging money, wasting it, and we should put it into education.
We're moving towards a different kind of age where work will really not be organized into jobs, where work will be organized in some other way, which is what we much of the time try to talk about, and people should get ready for this new way in which work will be organized.
As work changes, so must education and our attitudes towards it. In this series, we have talked a lot about change. Changes are taking place at a startlingly rapid pace because of new technology. We must wake up and notice these changes and understand the need to restructure work in order to survive the new technology. But the proposals presented in this series go beyond simple survival. They bring exciting new opportunities. Opportunities to work less at a job, opportunities for more space in our lives, for personal development, and for personal pursuits. Even opportunities to make school more exciting. Isn't this what our lives should be about? This series has been a success if it has started you asking questions about the direction in which work is headed in the future. If we can begin to envision this new direction and think about how we can make it a reality in our own lives, we have made a big step forward.